Peer, he had only DG over DU, he DF over DU, and he just this matrix H. Now, this lambda bracket, since it's written explicitly, it's easy to check what happens if you take lambda bracket of F with the product of two functions. It turns out that you get the usual Leibniz rule, which is written on the blackboard. But if you write lambda bracket the other way, FG lambda with H, then you get something more complicated. Then you get this. Which means that you replace lambda by lambda plus d, and then apply d to g. This means error. Also, you can prove that it's very easy to prove that the bracket given by this formula satisfies two what I call sesquilinearity properties, how to take d outside of the bracket. From the first position, you just put minus lambda, from the second position, you put in front lambda plus d. And then, of course, the question is, when this bracket on the, remember this bracket 7, on V mod dV. And an important question, when it satisfies Lie algebra axioms. And then it turns out that it satisfies Lie algebra axioms if and only if the lambda bracket satisfies, besides these properties which it satisfies automatically with the formula, you have Lie algebra bracket if and only if lambda bracket satisfies this, and this is responsible for skew commutativity of the Lie algebra bracket, and this identity is responsible for skew commutativity for the Jacobi identity of the lambda bracket, which is given by this formula. It's basically the same as the usual Jacobi identity, except that there are these additional decorations lambda. And one can prove, as in the finite dimensional case, that if you want to prove that this more complicated axiom holds, and especially, of course, axiom 4, it suffices to check that skew symmetry holds only on generators, and the Jacobi identity holds on any triple generators. Okay, thus we arrive at the following fundamental definition. The most fundamental of us will be definition of a Lie conformal algebra. So let me write again its axioms. So that you can see it all the time in front of you, because I've talked about it at some point. Namely, Lie conformal algebra say R is a module of the polynomials in D, endowed with lambda bracket. That you have these basic actions. First action is sesquilinearity, namely how you take out d from the first position and from the second position. And Jacobi identity. So it's very similar to the definition of Lie algebra, and really the key property of this algebra is can be proved in one line, namely that it induces the Lie algebra structure on R mod dr to the following formula: AB is equal to A lambda B when lambda is equal to Z. And as usual, the image, better to write integral, the image of A in the quotient. And moreover, A integral B is equal to A lambda B when lambda equals to zero is a representation of the Lie algebra R mod R. This is a basic statement which follows instantly from that. Okay, now let me repeat this again. This what I said is just the first line, that the definition of a Lie conformal algebra, that it is C of D modulo, F of D modulo, such that, yeah, I forgot to say an important thing, that it is actually polynomial in Lie. This is very important. So this is the first basic definition. The second basic definition is what is Poisson vertex algebra. And it is this. It's very close to the definition of what is Poisson algebra. You have unital differential algebra structure on V. And it's equipped with a lambda bracket instead of ordinary bracket. And this lambda bracket should satisfy axioms of Lie conformal algebra. Whereas in the for usual Poisson case, it satisfies axioms of usual Lie algebra. And as I said, the lambda bracket, the special case which was given by the formula, which I written a couple of transparencies ago, is a case that it satisfies axiom of a Poisson vertex algebra. It's called local Poisson structure. And in the finite dimensional case, it's just this matrix. So matrix of functions, and in this case, it's a matrix of differential operators, which is skew adjoint and satisfies the Jacobi identity. And by the way, Jacobi identity, which I said is a complicated cubic expression, is simply in order to check it, you check this last line on the right. Because this H defines your lambda bracket, and if this lambda bracket satisfies this cubic identity, then it means that you have a Poisson structure if H is skew adjoint. And the last piece of definition is that two Poisson structures are compatible if their sum is also a Poisson structure. It's a very easy definition, but it really, which was introduced by Magri in 78, of course in a different language, but this really plays an important role in the integral days. Okay, now let me give examples. The first example where you have just one function u, and the lambda bracket is u lambda u is equal to lambda. That's the corresponding, yeah, if you have lambda bracket, how to construct the corresponding differential order? You just replace lambda by d. So u lambda u equals lambda means the corresponding Hamiltonian operator is equal to d. So this was the very first structure for the partial differential evolution equation, which was introduced not so long ago, in 1971. It was introduced by Gardner and a little later by Fadeev and Zakharov. So it's called GFZ structure. And they showed how to use the structure in order to solve, in certain sense, KdV equation. Another structure was, which was discovered by Magri, and these days is called Virasoro-Magri structure because it is intimately related to the Virasoro algebra, as I will explain. If this differential operator of order 3, and of course you are not surprised that the corresponding lambda bracket is obtained by replacing d by lambda. So u lambda u is given by this. It's easy to check that they are compatible Poisson structure, their sum is again a Poisson structure, and therefore linear combination. So in other words, we have a three-parameter family of pairwise compatible Poisson structure. And the basic point is that the compatible Poisson structures allow one to prove integrability of equations by the so-called Linhart-Magri scheme, which I'm going to explain. So as far as I know, Linhart for the first time talked about this scheme somewhere in New York, maybe even in the University of New York, somewhere in late 60s. Kraskal was, where was he? In Colombia, I don't know. In Colombia. Ah, okay, so it was not very far from here, but in New York. Okay, so this is basic examples of lambda brackets. Yeah, there is another example which I discovered with my Italian friends, Arborel, De Concini, and Procesi in 88, which is this. Something like six-parameter family of Poisson structure. And it appeared in a completely different context. Namely, we studied cohomology of moduli spaces of curves. And one of the results that we proved that it is canonical isomorphic to the cohomology of this Lie conformal algebra for sufficiently large genus. And as I said, the corresponding lambda bracket is obtained by just replacing d by lambda, and by the way, taking transpose. But here, you see, I wrote only this, and I didn't write this, because adding this is just taking central extension. So you take this very simple Lie conformal algebra and take its maximal possible central extension, which turns out that you have actually 5-2 cocycles. That's why you have so many parameters. Okay, these are two examples which I decided to put in the blackboard. So let me recapitulate our basic definitions. That if you have a lambda bracket on a Poisson vertex algebra, then you can define Lie algebra bracket on V mod DV by just putting lambda equals zero. And you can define representation of this Lie algebra on the vector space V by the same formula. And then in this language, Hamiltonian equation is a very simple thing. Just du over dt is equal to integral of h bracket with u. It looks like it's dot instead of comma. And so integral of h is just image of h in V mod dv. So formulas are almost the same as in the finite dimensional case, except that instead of for Hamiltonian function, you take it not function, but rather as image in V mod dV. This is really the only difference. Okay, I will talk about integrability a little later, if I have time. If not, then not. But then now let me just go to digression to differential Lie algebras. How all this stuff, this Lie conformal algebras, which I, the axioms put here, causes are related to differential reactions. In one sentence, that's just exactly the same thing. Yeah, another question which probably somebody will ask, why is the name Poisson vertex algebra? Mm-hmm. Because, you know, there is a theory of vertex algebras which comes from conformal field theory. And Poisson vertex algebra is just a quasi-classical limit. That's all. Like if you have a family of associative algebra, the quasi-classical limit coefficient of Planck constant is a, it gives you a Poisson algebra, right? Here, in exactly the same fashion, quasi-classical limit of a family of vertex algebras gives you a Poisson vertex algebra. So they really appear very naturally in conformal quantum field theory.
What is a vertex algebra?
Yeah, it would take some time. It's the simplest example of a quantum field theory.
Okay.
Right. Simplest non-trivial example. All right, now let me explain the connection of Lie conformal algebras with differential Lie algebras. First of all, of course, everybody here knows that if you have a Lie algebra and a commutative associative unit of algebra, you can take tensor product, which again will be Lie algebra. Of course, a natural question is, if you have a Lie conformal algebra, can you define a tensor product with a differential algebra, right? And of course, yes, you just take tensor product and define the new derivation as d plus delta. If you have a differential algebra A delta, you just take tensor product and you extend derivation by extending it to A. So R tilde A delta is just a differential, is obviously a differential algebra. But now, is it, in an obvious way, a Lie conformal algebra? For usual Lie algebras, you just extend by bilinearity and that's it, you have a Lie algebra. But here it's more complicated. Here the right definition is this. If you want to define lambda bracket of an element of R tensor with function and an element B with a tensor with a function, then it is not quite taking bracket of A with B and tensor with product of A with G. You have to do this. And if you write out lambda bracket this finite sum, then explicitly it is given by this formula, which looks a little complicated, but in fact it's very simple, and I will explain what actually it means. For example, if you remember the Leibniz rule for Poisson vertex algebra, it is really a special case of it. So really must do it this way, otherwise you don't get a Lie conformal algebra. So let me show you a couple of examples of this construction, of R tilde A lambda. Yeah, and of course you get this Lie conformal algebra R tilde, but of course we know that if you divide Lie conformal algebra by the image of the derivation D, you get a Lie algebra. And so as a result, any Lie conformal algebra R and any differential algebra A delta, you associate in a very straightforward way some Lie algebra. And actually this Lie algebra carries a derivation, and you can take delta x unit. And it makes it a differential Lie algebra. So this is the construction. So in other words, you get any Lie conformal algebra defines you a functor from the category of differential algebras to the category of differential Lie algebras. Yeah, by just U2R, you associate this Lie algebra. You know, it's exactly the same way as a group scheme defines a functor from the category of commutative associative algebras to the category of groups. Because if you say General Linear Group. It's not a group. Right? It becomes a group if I give you the commutative ring. GLN of A, where A is a ring or a field, is a group. But GLN is not a group. Or SLN. It's an equation. The determinant is equal to 1. But before I tell you what are the coefficients, it's not a group. Similarly here is that the Lie conform algebra by itself is not a Lie algebra, it's not a differential algebra. But as soon as I provide you with a differential algebra A delta, you can construct the corresponding differential Lie algebra. And the corresponding examples are the following. Among Lie conform algebras, the two examples are the basic ones. Namely, first is associated to any, say, finite dimensional Lie algebra. It's called current Lie conform algebra. You just tensor f of d with this Lie algebra, and then you define lambda bracket. Lambda bracket between general. This you define as your ordinary bracket on the Lie algebra. Here I wrote for you not only this Lie algebra, but also its universal central extension, because they're important for the theory of integrable systems. And this corresponding central part is just one-dimensional, and it's a trivial f of d module. So it's called a current Lie conform algebra. And here I wrote for you what is the corresponding differential Lie algebra. Of course, if you disregard the central part, it's just the obvious thing, just tensoring this associative algebra. But the central extension is A mod delta A, and it's given by this form. And next, example explains why this is called Virasoro-Lie conform algebra. The lambda bracket is this, and if you want the central extension, you have to add this term, and then the corresponding differential Lie algebra is a very familiar, it's called substitutional Lie algebra, except you, and plus this central term. I don't know to what extent the central extension were part of the theory, but at least for integrable systems, it's very important. That is why this Lie conform algebra, or its central extension, is called the Virasoro Lie conform algebra, because the corresponding differential Lie algebra is Virasoro, the algebra of substitution. In fact, one can completely classify finite rank Lie conform algebras, and I give these two examples in order to state the theorem which we proved my student in at the end of last century, that every finite rank over C of D simple Lie conform algebra is one of these two. Of course, you want to them simple, you write them without central extension. And due to the correspondence with differential Lie algebra, it gives you classification of finitely generated simple differential Lie algebras. But also, one can classify all semisimple Lie conform algebras. Semisimple means that there are no solvable ideals or abelian ideals. And it is not only direct sums of simple, but also there is this one, semi-direct product of between these two examples, such that L lambda bracket is on the previous transparency, A lambda bracket is in here, and finally lambda bracket between L and A is just this d plus lambda applied to A. So they're all finite, semi-simple Lie conform algebras. Now, if you're interested in the simplest example, what are rank 1 Lie conform algebras? They're not necessarily trivial, Оце as read shown many years ago, just of substitutional type, namely any non-trivial rank 1 Lie conformology with Vera Soros. That is just
true. Yes.
In the next transparency, basically, I'll show an easy way to understand the correspondence between Lie conformal and differential Lie algebras. But now let me talk about more difficult theorem. So on classification problem, Reed had two papers, one in 1950 of rank 1, and more difficult in 1951 on rank 2.
Yeah.
Okay. So what is ZANS? ZANS is it's actually very beautiful. There are rank 2 nilpotent and solvable. And for some reason, nilpotent is called, of course, there is abelian trivial, which I disregard. For some reason, they switch in order. Nilpotent is called, how's it called, finite, third finite type, and this is called second finite type. And abelian is called the first finite. All the rest, they contain Vera Soros, and they are called of substitutional type, naturally. And what they are? The answer is that it's either just direct sum of trivial one and Vera Soros, or it is direct sum of two Vera Soros, and these are called the, I suppose, first and second substitutional type. The third substitutional type is depends on one parameter. It's Vera Soros. V is lambda break. It generates one-dimensional abelian ideal. The only thing which he managed to say was lambda bracket of L with V. And the intersection did this. And it's very easy to understand, because this gives you one-dimensional representation of the Vera Soros Lie conformal algebra. And an easy theorem is that these are all one-dimensional representations for arbitrary delta. The parameter is just by one parameter. Okay. Now what is the next? F? Yeah, the most remarkable is actually the last case, when it is not a semi-direct product. So you have a one-dimensional ideal, which is abelian, and L lambda V, therefore, is again a multiple of V, and it is of the same type as here. It should be delta. But the lambda bracket of L with itself, it's not just Vera Soros, but there is this additional term where P delta is some polynomial. And the question is how to compute this polynomial. And the answer is that such a non-zero polynomial exists if and only if delta takes one of these five values. And moreover, in the case when delta is 0 or minus 1, you get a one-parameter family. And now what are these polynomials? Or if you want two-parameter family, but up to multiple, so it is. Yeah, and what is the reason for these deltas? Because you can compute cohomology of Lie conformal algebra. Mm-hmm. You can compute cohomology. So what do we want? We want extensions by abelian ideals. So in other words, the parameter is by H2 of Yeah, I'm sorry, here is a misprint. It should be HQ. Because we computed HQ for any Q. And the answer is that the answer is that HQ is equal to zero if delta is not of this form, where r is a non-negative integer. These are, of course, the pentagonal numbers. Is two-dimensional when q, so here should be q. If q is equal r plus one, and delta is a pentagonal number, and it's one dimensional if Q is R or R plus 2, where delta is again a pentagonal number. So this answer for any Q. And if you take Q equals 2, you immediately recover the thing which written in the previous transparency. It's also easy to show the degree of polynomials at most 3 minus delta. And you can write down all these polynomials. They become more symmetric if you put x equals d plus lambda and y equals minus lambda. But actually, this form is important because they explain you how to move from Lie conformal algebras to differential Lie algebras and back.
Is this in your paper with Bagalov and Bogomolov?
Yeah, this we computed cohomology on many examples.
Are you going to leave?
But we didn't write about rank 2, unfortunately.
Do you have a copy of your slides?
Yeah, actually, I think that Alyosha has.
Yeah,
that's wonderful.
Okay. So this is a list of polynomials. So there is only one polynomial in 3 cases, and as I said, 2 polynomials in each of the remaining cases. And these polynomials are exactly those which appear in the paper of Phyllis. I tried to read, I just cannot read a single line in his paper.
Oh, have to rewrite it.
Yeah. Phyllis, it's much easier to read. Mm. Phyllis, and for some reason he didn't write the last polynomial, but Phyllis did.
Yeah, but Boris Weisweiler told me he felt some were missing. When he looked at Ritt's list,
this was... No, he writes that I will not write down this polynomial, something like that.
Oh, okay.
He had this phrase.
Okay.
So he knew that
he knew,
exists.
He knew, yeah.
But for some reason he didn't write. It's not such
no,
a good...
No, he didn't write it, no.
Yeah, I'm already out of time, but let me now explain what this theorem holds. First, of course, you have to use this cohomology result. But what is actually the basic argument of classification? So you want to classify rank 2 Lie conformal algebra. So which is what? Which is f of d. Say L plus direct sum of three modules of rank 1, F of D. Okay. Now, can they be? Yes, and the general theorem says what? That any Lie conformal algebra R contains solvable. Maximum solvable ideal such that R mod rad R is missing. Okay. What are the cases when the radical is trivial? So it's rank 2 semisimple Lie conformal algebra. What there are? Semidirect product with current is the current of G, which is impossible because G is at least 3-dimensional, which is the minimum with SF2. So this is root out. Or semi-direct product of one-dimensional and one-dimensional. But one-dimensional can be only Virasoro. So the other one is either also Virasoro or is abelian idea. So this gives you the first case when it is L plus L. If it is abelian ideal, then either it is direct sum, which was one of the cases, or L lambda V is equal to d plus delta lambda. You remember that this is an ideal. And this also gives of one of the substitutional types. Of course, if the semi-simple part is zero, then it is either nilpotent or solvable. And this case is easily set. Now, and what now remains? Remains that L with L is like modulo V is Virasoro, but possibly it could be an additional term which disappears if you divide by this one-dimensional abelian ideal. And L lambda V is D plus delta lambda V. So that there is this also this parameter. Another that you study, when there exist non-trivial abelian extensions. And by this cohomology for Q equals 2, you get there are only finitely many cases. Namely, there are five cases when five deltas for which cohomology is non-trivial, and so on and so forth. And after that, and you know the degree is bounded by 3 minus delta, maximum delta is minus 6, so 3 minus delta is 9. So maximum degree of this polynomial is 9. So you write the arbitrary equation with coefficient, checks the Jacobian identity, finds the field. Because this answer. So it's a very kind of simple straight. So the only difficult point is, of course, compute the cohomology. And it sounds that it's easy to compute the full cohomology rather than the HD. Because then you can use cohomological techniques to do that. So this is how one does. Okay, let me just finish. Unfortunately, I didn't have time to talk about the Lennard-Magri scheme. But let me explain you explicitly how one goes from differential algebra to Lie conformal algebra and back. If you have a differential algebra, what is the corresponding Lie conformal algebra? I consider it without torsion. By the way, torsion is always central. I consider the case when it's a free module. My understanding is that this is the definition, that if you take the bracket of arbitrary elements from L, it should have this form, where Qij of k is a polynomial of delta 1, delta 2. Delta 1 is derivation which acts on uis, and delta 2 is derivation which acts on vj's. Now, if you introduce polynomial Pij, which are related to Q by this simple linear substitution, which I wrote in the previous transparency, and you define lambda bracket by this formula, you get a Lie conformal algebra. And conversely, if you, by the way, the converse substitution, this substitution square is identity, so the converse substitution looks exactly the same. If you have a Lie conformal algebra, make the converse substitution, introduce Qs, then this formula on the top gives you a differential algebra. So as I said, it's really the same thing, just a linear substitution. Okay, thank you.
Questions?
Are you going to leave your notes right away?
Sorry?
Are you going to leave a copy of your slides right away?
Yeah, sure. Yeah, if you want, I can leave. Okay, especially cool. Since there are misprints. But then you should, yeah, maybe I, for you, I will change this to Q.
Q, yeah.
Yeah, this is the most horrible.
That's okay.
And also you can read it. Right? Yeah, HQ.
Thank you very much.
Except that maybe I will need it in
you
the afternoon.
Yeah, well,
then you'll bring
I
back.
Won't go away.
So we'll continue in the afternoon talk for.
At 2 o'clock, okay.
This one. Okay. 2 o'clock.